Hey, ajmahari here. In this video, I hope to answer a question that was posed on a video recently, and I just have a little announcement, but maybe not yet because I'm not sure what he's doing. Come here, buddo. What are you doing? What are you doing? Come here. Wow. Sorry about this. Come here, buddy. Hey, buddy, come here. That's it. Come here, little guy. Whoa, 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 whoa. Another new puppy. They're not coming every day, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. But this, got any name suggestions? I'm always doing this, aren't I? This little guy is a 9-week-old, purebred Rottweiler. See? Pretty big guy for 9 weeks, but... Yeah, he arrived yesterday. We got him yesterday, my partner and I, didn't we? And so he's still getting acclimated and he's just settling down right now from like 5 minutes in the crate because that's where his food and water is. And so he went in there and then I just closed the door behind him and you didn't notice until you finished eating and drinking, right? And then it was like, I gotta get out. I gotta get out. And he whined and he whined. So he's already learned how to play fetch. He's brilliant, like most Rottweilers are. So this guy's gonna be properly trained. He's gonna probably be about 90 pounds when he grows up, maybe a little more. And he'll be trained with a lovely attack command to only be used, of course, under the proper circumstances. But Rotties are such sweet dogs, and yes, they are good guard dogs, but he's a pet, but he will have that sort of guard dogish thing inside of him too, won't you? Yes. Yes, definitely. So anyway, here's a little guy, and takes me forever to name them, so we can expect that to be the same for anybody who's watched other videos when I've introduced a puppy. Which I'm not always getting puppies, so yeah. Anyway, my partner was like, we don't need another dog, do we? And I'm like, well, a Rottweiler, yeah. Because actually it was my partner, one of her sons, that actually had the Rotties. And I was like, they have what? She was like, I knew when you heard you were gonna have to have one. But definitely, because it's not often that there's a lot of purebred Rotties, especially he's, I believe, of the European stock, not American Rottweiler, and there's nothing wrong with American Rottweilers, it's just a difference in the shape of the head, actually. Right, little guy? You don't know the difference. He's such a little sweetie. So anyways, I'm trying to think of a name. Looked at the top 10 popular names for male Rottweilers, and of course... There are things like Diesel, Tank, Rocco, maybe Brutus, things like that, right? All these sort of tough sounding names in the top 10, not all the names. So, but this boy's going to have some size because with my Rotti Cross Jake, who's 10 years old now, and kind of going a little downhill, unfortunately. He was a Rotti Cross, and he was always smaller, well, 60 pounds, you know. But he never had the big Rotti head that this little dude's going to have. Anyway, if you like Rottweilers, maybe you enjoyed this. And if you don't like dogs or Rottweilers, maybe not. So, anyway, the question I got asked, let's see if he wants to stay with me or not. I can put him down. On a video I did a while back was... it was a statement and a question. One of the reasons... I believe as codependents, we worry about people, what people think. Hey, buddy. We worry about what people think about us. In my experience with my BPDX, her family knew it wasn't my fault because they know the way she is. They would comment even once in a while how I stand her. How could I stand her? Or that she was crazy and tell me to leave. Excuse me. And tell me to leave her, and if they knew, as if they knew the person who commented, the fate that they were about to encounter, which is really painful, as people know, after BPD relationship breakups, and that just moved. Okay. Hey, buddy. Mwah. And then The commenter said, but I think a great video would be what makes a person with BPD come to the realization that they have a problem and so that they go and seek help. Well, first of all, what the commenter said in the beginning might be true for their situation, of course, right? But not everybody who's dating a person with BPD, whether that's a male or a female, is going to have the family support or is going to have a family that acknowledges the issues that are happening with their adult child. So that's not always the case. Mm-hmm. Do you want to get down? Just let me know. Yeah, I think you're letting me know. Okay. And then, hey buddy, you are heavy already. It's like 15 pounds or something at 9 weeks old. Okay. And then, so that I thought was important to just mention. And whether or not you get any cues or clues, okay, buddy, okay, from the family of the person that has been diagnosed with BPD or that is suspected to perhaps have BPD, it may or may not happen, right? So a lot of people with BPD who've been diagnosed or who may be able to be diagnosed with BPD but haven't gone in to see anybody to be assessed, a lot of them can be very enmeshed with family of origin, and there can be a lot of enmeshment and collusion that isn't consciously done. But so they can really defend hard against a partner or an ex that might say, hey, you know, your daughter or your son. And, but then in this person's case, the family understood, and the family was actually concerned for the person who's now the ex of the person with BPD. So the other question, they thought that it would make a great video. It really won't. I'm sorry to say as I'm making this video. Why somebody with BPD comes to the realization, now you want back up, that they have a problem and they seek help. Well, the first thing that goes with that is, pardon me for ducking out of the camera, but maybe he wants back up. The first thing that I have to say, Buffy, leave that with this answer, is what I'm always saying here to try to really bring home this point, and there's so many reasons for this point. Go lay down, Buff. Not all people with BPD are the same. So they can have core patterns. They can have core adverse experience in childhood. They manifest, many of them, not all the same ways, but in various different pattern ways. Core pattern things that indicate that they're having this difficulty, whether they're diagnosed or undiagnosed. And as I said in another video, so the key thing is that there are as many reasons or motivations for some people with BPD, get your butt up here, buddy, for some people with BPD to seek treatment as there are as many, if not more, motivations, which are usually unconscious on the side of not seeking treatment for BPD, as there are individuals with BPD. So it's not a one-size-fits-all answer by any means. And I think what motivates a lot of people, hey, you make up your own mind. You're either up here or you're down there, you know. I think a lot of people seek treatment for BPD because they're aware. They might not know that they might have been diagnosed. They might have been told. They might not have been. They might not be diagnosed yet, whatever. But a lot of people seek treatment for BPD because of the pain and of the relational difficulties. And they gain awareness in different ways. When, sorry about this. Buffy, go lay down. It's a zoo in here of sorts. But a happy one. So some people get more awareness that they could really use some help because they want to change, because they're in so much pain. And they don't want to continue to be in that kind of pain. And then the irony is that the beginning of therapy can be very painful. And then it takes a little bit of time to start reaping positive benefits from that. So as a certain percentage of people, I don't know what percentage, I would say it's a lesser percentage that do get motivated and seek help than those who don't. And in that likely larger percentage of people that don't seek help or haven't yet, or may never, unfortunately, that they are motivated in the opposite way by the pain and the relational difficulties because they continue to think it's everybody else's fault and they continue to feel like they're the you know, the victim of it all. And so they don't think there's any reason to seek help because with NPPD, there is awareness impairment. And then it depends how many psych meds somebody's put on top of that that will impair awareness even more. Because I want to say it again, as is said by a professional association in the United Kingdom, but I'm in Britain, but I'm sure elsewhere, it's known that psychiatric medication, this is a direct quote, quote, psychiatric medication is contraindicated in the treatment of borderline personality disorder, end quote. But the difficulty there, and I'm not speaking about meds, it's not really something that I'm qualified to do. Do you want to go down now? The difficulty there is that some people have other existing issues with BPD, but not all. A higher percentage, hey, come on guys, a higher percentage, but not all. Puppy, right now, go, lay down. Puppy's not still so thrilled with a puppy. And the puppy's scared of Puppy. We'll work it out. So many people seek treatment for BPD because of the pain they're in, because of painful relating, and wondering why that is. And equally, if not more people, because of that same pain, but without that awareness of like the painful relating being having anything to do with them, they run from treatment. They run the other direction. They're in denial. They're very afraid. They may not believe that they can be treated or helped with BPD. And they may feel really, really badly about themselves. And they may be so shamed that they believe they don't even deserve to feel better or deserve help. And they may be afraid to feel better because of the ingrained repetition compulsion patterns within BPD or the patterns of BPD if somebody hasn't been diagnosed yet that might be diagnosable with BPD. So the motivators are many, multiple, and almost as many as besides this pain factor motivator in one direction or the other, the majority of people often it's away from treatment and it's not my problem, it's your problem, etc. And a certain number of people, percentage of people that do seek treatment. And I think another thing that's really important to know about this, if you don't already, is that while DBT is an excellent modality for people with BPD, it is not the only one. And in fact, I haven't yet read anywhere, found anywhere through all my research that DBT is actually a recovery modality for BPD. Some say it is, some say it isn't, but I don't think Dr. Linehan weighed in one way or the other. So the most effective, known to be a modality of therapy that helps people recover from BPD. Throughout the word remission, throughout the narrative of the APA, and look around at other information out there. There's tons of it. I'm not the only one saying this stuff. That transference-focused psychotherapy, which was created by two psychiatrists, Dr. Gunderson, who is a leading pioneer and expert in borderline personality disorder, and as is Dr. Frank Yeomans. And what do each of them say as psychiatrists about their own modality of treatment for borderline personality disorder? People can recover. They actually use the word recover. They don't just say remit, whatever that means, because that's a whole other thing for a whole other video. And I've talked about that before. So transference-focused psychotherapy is still probably the most complete modality for the most complete recovery from borderline personality disorder that exists out there. DBT is ranked highly, of course. It's effective in many ways. I and many and much of my research has shown it's just not necessarily a recovery modality in the same way that transference-focused psychotherapy is. And then there's schema therapy, mentalization-based treatment as well, and other things, but those are probably the core. Some people end up with some cognitive behavioral therapy, either mixed in with other modalities or what have you. But here's the thing. I think this is just an anecdotal thought of mine, right? Based on all the clients I've worked with over 32 years, all the research I do, all the reading I do, of textbooks still, but of like, studies and such, which really, again, remember from the American Psychiatric Association in America, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, those studies are not replicated. They are, so they're not, I'm not saying psychiatry or psychology would be pure science. but you need replication and you need criticism. And they don't allow psychiatrists in psychiatry, as far as I know still, and I heard this from a psychiatrist, several actually, that I've interviewed and or had correspondence with for reasons why they emailed me, not the other way around. I'm not seeking any psychiatric care, just to be clear. That the fact is that, yes, they can't write any criticism to any of the conclusions of studies in the American Psychiatric Association in their journals. Like a psychiatrist can't write into a journal with a critic. So if you don't have criticism of results and you don't have replication of results in these studies, you don't have studies. You have flawed ideology. So I've said that a lot. But here's the other thing I wanted to say about this. So what motivates one person to seek treatment for BPD? And what won't motivate a plethora of people, a big percentage of people? Like I said, I gave one example, but there are probably others, but they're harder to identify because these are so individual. But I guess the overall thing is whether someone is aware or not that they could be helped, whether they are courageous enough, because it takes courage, to realize that, yeah, this might hurt some too, but I can get better. I can learn how to cope. I can find out who I am. So it's therapy for BPD is very difficult and challenging for people to maintain and stick with. People do it. People heal. People recover. And so, and some people get to maybe not there, and that's not perfection, recovery, but they get to maybe really close to that, or they really get to what Linehan described as they create a life worth living, and they learn how to relate better through a lot of treatment. And of course, Dr. John Gunderson is quoted as saying for recovery from BPD takes anywhere from 8 to 16 years. Now that recovery means they no longer split. They are no longer having all these defense mechanisms that are housed within BPD and all the other problems. That's true for lots of people. So I think that for me, as the person said, it would make a great video to talk about this. I don't think this is the greatest video because for so many of you out there, the person in your life, being an adult child, a sibling, a parent, or you have a parent and or an ex with BPD, it's not good news because so many of them aren't seeking treatment. There's more treatment available now for BPD than ever before, and it can be recovered from. It can be healed. It can be changed. And yet, because neuroplasticity is real, and yes, I did catch one back and said something recently about self-help and therapy and psychology or psychiatry, whatever he's talking about, nothing's going to help you change. Nothing's going to help you. It's all, everybody's lying to you. No, it would be Sam Bachman that's, quote, lying to you, because he's a malignant psychopath that it's true for him to say he can't change. It's true for him to say that all the self-help and unfortunately maybe all the therapy in the world even, he wouldn't be able to change because there's nothing that can be done for psychopathy, let alone the malignant narcissism is pretty like difficult for anyone to treat. So when he said that, I just wanted to, like, I just recalled that. Sorry for putting it in here, maybe. It doesn't fit. I don't know. But when he said that, he couldn't be further from the truth. People help themselves by listening to videos. People help themselves by, listening to podcasts, reading books, researching things. And so if you're not a malignant narcissist psychopath, there's all, if you have BPD, if you're codependent, if you think you might be a codependent, whether it be traits of BPD or something else in the mix, there's all the reason in the world to know that if you seek help, and I'm not here to work with you, but I resonate with you in the processes that I use, and I've been working with clients for 32 years, that you can heal, that you can change, that you can grow, but you can only do it for yourself. So the key thing to this question about what motivates people with BPD to get therapy or what doesn't, you know, I think the vast majority, many more that are never going to be motivated to get help versus a certain percentage that are and do and will, is that if you're somebody with codependency and you have somebody with BPD in your life in any capacity, maybe you have an ex with BPD, maybe you're in an on and off relationship with somebody with BPD, maybe you also have a parent with BPD. Maybe you're aware of it, maybe you're not, maybe they're diagnosed, maybe they're not. But again, those patterns and the experiences, hey little guy, don't eat my chair, it's a new chair. Anyway, it's really important for people with codependency asking this question, thinking this would be a great video, thank you for your vote of confidence, but it isn't really, because the real true news that I have to deliver here in this video is that for more of you than not, the people that you know or care about or have been a significant other relationship with or love in another relationship type, more of them are not going to get treatment than are. And I don't know who's who, and you can't know who's who. So this is why my message to people with codependency is always, at a certain point in time, and after so many devaluation splits and are being ghosted or discarded or the breakups or the, I just need 3 weeks to figure this out, which nobody needs 3 weeks to figure something. It's just something that people with BPD say, and then usually they're gone. And if they do come back, you're going to go around the same silly cycle, very painful cycle, all over again. He wants up, he wants down, he wants in, he wants out. So unfortunately, in this video, to be really honest with you, the onus again falls on people with codependency to be able to, even if somebody that you are with is in therapy, it may, in very rare amounts of cases, mean you can go forward. But the person with codependency also needs to be in their own healing recovery process. And those need to be two separate processes, the person with BPD in their own therapy and the person with codependency in their own process of healing and recovery. So, right to the ear. So the other thing is, if you have a name suggestion, and the other thing is that it's really not great news still that there's more and more help out there than ever before for BPD, and people can truly recover, but so many will never seek it out. So if you're in a situation where you're wondering about this, why do some and why don't others? Well, they're all individuals, so there's not just one answer for sure. It's complicated, and you can't change somebody's mind, you know? That's a codependent thing to try to do that's self-abandoning you. So the key thing is, if you're with somebody or you've been with somebody, you've been ghosted, you're on and off again, all that, or it's a relative and or a parent or whatever the case, you are powerless. So the people with codependency have to realize you are powerless to change them. And so what is the action step that you need to take then from that point of powerlessness? Get into your own healing and recovery journey for codependency, making difficult choices if you have to end the relationship or if they've ended it already on you, which is very painful and difficult to deal with. BPD relationship breakup, surviving it. I have a lot on that on this channel and my podcast. And the thing is, this is where people with codependency need to look to self and to your own healing process, because that's what you have agency over, or control over. I don't like to use the word control too much, but agency over. You can empower yourself. You can learn and grow. And the best way to get out of these unhealthy bonds in the first place, be it a mother, be it a sibling, be it a friend, be it a, you know, an ex or a current person that you're with in a relationship, the best way to heal out of that unhealthy bond is by seeking your own process of healing and recovery from codependency. Because the reason you have codependency, where that goes back to in family of origin, and the correlation there and the tie-in that I've seen in patterns for 32 years working with clients, is it goes back in your unconscious. People aren't consciously aware of this when they have codependency. But the answers to your healing recovery and getting out of that unhealthy bond relationship starts with you seeking your own healing and recovery journey. Because you have agency over that and you can choose that, but you can't. You can drag the person with borderline personality to the therapy or the horse to water, but you can't make them drink. So this is where people keep, with codependency, keep on letting themselves down and abandoning themselves. Hey, little guy, what'd you get yourself stuck in now? And the other thing is that you need to realize that You're not going to be the savior. You're not going to be the rescuer. You're not going to be the fixer. And you know what? I talk to a lot of people. I have a lot of clients, and I have had thousands or even over the, you know, a million, I don't know, in 32 years. And the thing is, it's not uncommon for clients to say to me, and I've heard it recently as well, as I will hear it from time to time, often actually, excuse me here, it's hard doing a video with a puppy, you know, but like it's fun. A lot of people with codependency, whether they're aware of it or not, are truly seeking to get the person back who you thought that person with BPD was, or a person who's not diagnosed but has all these patterns of really relational and emotional difficulties, and then some in life. So just know that that's the other part of this, is you're not going to ever get back to who you thought they were. Never. Not even if they go to treatment and they heal and recover in 8-10 years, and you go through your process, you give it usually a good couple of years for people, depending on the severity of codependency. Well, then there's going to be growth. And healing and recovering codependents, or recovered codependents, are going to grow away from wanting to be with a person who might be in therapy to heal and recover from BPD, as they're going to be growing away from you. Because therapy and healing and recovery journeys change people profoundly, and it doesn't bring people back together. So I think that's the really important message in all this. And sorry I've gone on so long, but hopefully this answers the question in a way that makes sense, because there are still more people today with all the therapy available out there. Mind you, there's over 50% of mental health professionals in America that don't want to work with people with BPD. It's probably somewhere in the 40% or higher range in Canada. Same in the Western world. It's getting worse, not better. There's a lot of obstacles, and people have to be really determined. And a lot of people with BPD, more than not, really, are not going to seek help, or certainly not anytime soon, depending how old they are, or they're not going to seek treatment. And that means that nothing can really change. And even if a person with BPD is seeking treatment and they're having some success and they're making some changes, if you're a codependent with them and you don't go and get in your own healing recovery journey, then they will leave you. And I happen to know this from personal experience, because when I healed and recovered from BPD, and I was told by therapists, I didn't say I cured myself from BPD or any of the nonsense. You'll read and you'll hear in videos out there, urban legends about me. You have to make up your own mind. There's nothing I can do about what people say based on things that they can't know. But the bottom line is that I know that I was motivated to seek treatment. I started at the age of 15. I wasn't even labeled yet. And by the way, I was labeled. I was never diagnosed with borderline personality disorder, just to make that clear. It's clear as mud, but it's true. So I never was categorically diagnosed with BPD, though I think I had 3 to 4 really strong traits of it. I'm not sure that I ever fit the diagnosis because I was never assessed. But that is now, you know, revisionist history and doesn't matter in my case. But the bottom line is, the false hope of people with codependency and wanting to understand this question of why does one person get motivated to go and stay with treatment like I did, many people have. I did, and I healed and I recovered, which doesn't make me perfect or anything, just saying. And then, so lots of people are doing that, and they're getting through to the recovery. And then how come so many aren't? Well, it's awareness versus lack of awareness to a certain extent at some point. And when I first went to therapy at the age of 15 myself, it was because I'd had a lot of childhood adverse experience and then some, and I was having panic and anxiety attacks, and I just knew something was really wrong, and I didn't know what it was, and I had no idea. And it turns out I never fit the label of BPD, which is the honest to God's truth. I'm not trying to walk anything back now that I've ever said, because I have the experience of having had the label put on me with no assessment. And then, but I'm not saying I had zero patterns, but I did extensive therapy to work through and heal that, as others have done and others will do. But we don't know who's who. And even when somebody starts that process and you've been in a rocky relationship, it's never going to come back to the way it was. And in fact, when people with BPD get better or are getting better toward recovery and being healed, they're never going to be, in the case of a lot of women that is talked about a lot and I've talked about here, they're not going to be hypersexual again. They're not going to be the same. They're not going to be as intense. They're not going to be everything that you as a codependent, for reasons that you didn't know consciously, were so drawn in by because of childhood woundedness, aside from the adult component of attraction and intensity. But why were you looking for more intensity than healthier people are? So there's no one size fits all answer. In fact, if there are answers, there are probably as many answers for why people do get motivated to go to treatment with BPD and work it through and heal and recover, why people don't, as there are people with BPD who do go to treatment or don't go to treatment. Just know that you can't change that for them and that you owe it to yourself to get into your own healing and recovery process, to heal your codependency and to become, to go from being a codependent to an independent person and breaking free of unhealthy bonds and what that will really yield you and bring to you in amazing change in all kinds of areas, but especially emotionally and in the increasing of your emotional intelligence, because your IQ might be really high, but EQ is knowing you, right? And the more you build up your EQ, it's an emotional process, this change. That's true for people with BPD as well. But as for why one is motivated to go to treatment and one isn't, and of course, there are many, many more than one, right? But there's just no way to, like, it's because of this, and that. The bottom line is people with codependency have to let go. And to let go, you usually need to work with someone to be able to let go, because there are things in your unconscious, not in your conscious awareness, that go back to family of origin and childhood that are keeping you stuck in this cycle in the here and now, and you think it's all about the here and now, and it just never is, as I've seen in 32 years worth of working with clients. So, introduction to the Rotti Puppy, if you have any name suggestions, and I hope that this made sense as to why I answered this the question this way, and that I'm saying as I'm doing it, I don't think it makes for a great video, because again, my message comes back to, the onus is on each individual person with BPD, and many will never make that choice for a bare, you know, whatever their individual reasons are, and they might not even be aware of them. Many will make the choice, but you don't know who's who. And most of you out there online, and if you're watching my videos, and most of the clients I work with, most, I've had a few, it's different, but again, very rare. Most are with people that are not going to seek treatment, with people with BPD and or NPD. And most are with people, most are codependent to begin with, most of you, no offense. And then secondly, you're trying to affect change that you need for yourself through somebody else who doesn't want any change. Doesn't want to, they might need in a way and show you that they need or want to be rescued, but they really don't want that because they're ensconced in unconscious, from the unconscious place, the reenactment of repetition compulsion cycles that they're not even consciously aware of. So long sort of winded video to say, but this is why it's so important that people with codependency, when somebody isn't seeking treatment, that's where you have to start to learn how to let go and take care of yourself. And I'm out here to work with people, if you resonate with me, on just how to do that. And I'm not saying it's easy or simple. It's not. It's complicated. It has all to do with emotions. And it does go back to what caused a codependency in your life, adverse experience in your family of origin in the first place, which that also is vastly different for a plethora of people with codependency, because each and every one of you, too, are individuals. Patterns only take us so far in understanding. So, and in this case, Why will some people with BP reach out for treatment? Why will so many more not? And who's who, we can't know. And so, you know, it's important that people with codependency learn that you're giving away your agency, that you have a pattern from childhood for whatever reason. Some people know, some people have no idea. It's sometimes it takes a lot of examination in a process of healing and recovery, how I work with clients. The thing is that people with codependency need to understand what caused the codependency for you, each and every one of you, because it's not a blanket cause. It's somewhat related in people's lives, but to varying degrees and in different kind of iterations and families of origin and set accompanying dysfunctions, and again, to varying degrees. So anyway, I hope that was helpful. I hope you enjoyed meeting the puppy. Sorry it's so long. If you made it this far, thank you and bless you. And so I'm out here to work with you if I resonate with you. And remember, as a codependent, as a person who might really love and care about somebody with BPD, because many of them have many positive qualities, along with the obvious things that cause other people and themselves a great amount of pain, you just can't fix them, change them, rescue them. Enabling them blocks their ability to try to make a choice for change, but you just have no agency or control over that. So it's time to take your agency and control over you back, and time to like get into your own healing and recovery process. And I know that even when people do this work, as I work with clients and many have healed from codependency, there can often still be leftover feelings of care, concern, worry for people with BPD that are in all kind of precarious situations, not all, but many are, with, you know, substances, etc., and doing things that may well not help them survive, right? Do the opposite. It's very much something that stays in people's hearts to a degree, but not to a degree that keeps people hoping to create change in the other person. Because you have to remember, at the core of codependency, in the unconscious of people with codependency, before they seek actual help and process and healing recovery journey, is that you're trying to make, help, fix, rescue the other person to feel better, so that you can get your needs met. And that's not a conscious situation either. So hope this was helpful. And for some people, probably they never got to the end. But anyway, that's the best I can do with that question. And would that I had the magical answer as to why this a big amount of people aren't seeking treatment, and this certain amount of people are, because if only we could apply what they're doing or what I did in my own life to what other people aren't doing, who wouldn't want to do that, right? But getting into a healing recovery journey for codependency will help you to be able to have limits and boundaries around that, help you to be healing the pain of rumination, cognitive dissonance, and much more, so that you realize that that's not your responsibility. You might still care about the person, but you don't need them to be okay for you to be okay. But that's how it is until you get into your own healing and recovery journey from codependency. So if you have any name suggestions for the Rotti Pup, that'd be great. And otherwise, if you have questions about this or comments, please do leave them below the video. And as always, take care. And I hope that was helpful or food for thought.